Well, I started out down a dirty road. Started out all alone, and the sun went down as I crossed the hill, and the town lit up. The world got still. I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings. Coming down is the hardest thing. Well, the good old days may not return, and the rocks might melt.
So it is not surprising that some would have us stay where we are a little longer, to rest, to wait.
Now, and as other people say, we've got to train for the Mars mission, which is a good idea, but we need to train for it on the moon. And you certainly could train for the Mars mission on the moon, but you could do it in the high Arctic with 1/1000th the cost. In a place like this, you can practice for the Mars mission, and you can do it this summer. The delta V's, the velocity changes, needed to go to the surface of the moon from low Earth orbit are actually greater than those needed to go to the surface of Mars from Earth orbit. So even if there was a Cape Canaveral on the moon today, already built for us, and they were giving out free propellant to anybody who would stop by, it would still not make sense to go to the moon on your way to Mars. And they have this thing that they're touting, you may have heard it, called the Vasimir. It's a plasma thruster. They claim that if they had this advanced electric thruster called Vasimir, you could get a one-way transit time to Mars of 39 days. That assumes that you would have a nuclear reactor source with a power density of a kilogram per kilowatt. Actual space nuclear reactors, the best one ever built, which was the Soviet Topaz, had a power density not of 1 kilogram per kilowatt, but of 100 kilograms per kilowatt. And even if we put that aside and say, well, we can improve on that, which we can, and you take the numbers that NASA hoped to achieve on its Jupiter icy moon orbiter mission, which was something the Bush administration was attempting, what they were hoping to achieve was 65. Okay, you know, lower the better, lighter is good. Well, if you use that number, what you find is that the one-way transit time to Mars with this technology is not 39 days, or even the 180 days that we can do right now with chemical thrusters, but 1,400 days. Electric propulsion is not a way to go fast. And by the way, in addition to the fact that it offers no benefits, you can see here's a NASA depiction of a nuclear electric spaceship. But you can see it's quite large. Mars is here for scale. Saying that we need that is an excuse not to actually launch the program. Okay? You know, it's like you saying, yes, I'm going to climb Mount Rainier, and I will do it just as soon as teleportation is available. There's two kinds of radiation that can get you in interplanetary space. There's solar flares and there's cosmic rays. Now, if you're on Mars, actually, you're in pretty good shape because the Martian atmosphere is thick enough to mask out solar flares. So you could be out in the open on Mars and get a minor dose from a solar flare. On Mars, the cosmic ray dose is about a factor of 4 down from space. Because, first of all, you have Mars under you, which blocks out half the sky right there. And then there's the atmosphere, which averages across the 2 pi steradians of the great dome of the sky to 65 centigrams per centimeter. Now, the solar flares can deliver like 1,000 or several thousand rems of radiation to an unshielded astronaut, which is enough to kill them, or either immediately or after a fairly brief period of radiation sickness. That's the bad news. The good news, however, is that what solar flares are made of is protons with energies of a few million electron volts. And that can be stopped by 5 inches of water, or things that from the nuclear point of view are basically water, such as food, or things that water and food become as the mission develops. And we have enough of that on board the ship to pack it in around a limited central area and create a shielded shelter, kind of like a pantry storm shelter. Okay, so you stack your food and your water and other provisions and the wastes around this, and you can have a heavily shielded area, which if a solar flare happens, the alarm bell rings and everybody comes in here and they're crammed in there for a few hours until it's over and the all clear rings and they come out. And that's how you're safe against solar flares. But more or less we're talking 1% risk here. Okay, not so high. It's not something the FDA would recommend for the general public. But you need to put it in perspective. If you are an average American and you do not smoke, you have right now a 20% risk that you will die of cancer. This would make it 21. If you're an average American smoker, it's 40. So in fact, if we recruited the crew out of smokers and sent them to Mars without their tobacco, we would be reducing their chance of getting cancer. So one very good reason to send people to Mars might be for their health. Why are we going to Mars? We're going to Mars because it's the planet that has on it the resources to support life and therefore potentially civilization. If we make intelligent use of them, the same resources that make Mars interesting are also what make it accessible. So what do you actually need to go to Mars if you really wanted to go to Mars as opposed to looking for excuses not to go? Well, you do need a launch vehicle. This launch vehicle, which we call the Ares, after the Greek name for Mars. And the Ares is basically a junkyard special. That is to say, it was designed to be built out of things that could be found in junkyards. I mentioned it could lift 120 tons to Leo, and it can. But because it has an upper stage, it has an additional capability. It can throw payloads far beyond Leo. It can throw them on a direct trajectory to Mars. And that's how we want to do the mission. Just lift and throw and let it go. Send the payload to the planet with this upper stage of the same launch vehicle that launched it to orbit in the first place. That's how we've done every real robotic planetary mission. That's how we did the real Apollo missions to the moon. No one's ever launched any mission beyond Leo by lifting it to orbit, keeping it at the orbiting spaceport, waiting for the Death Star to come back on its latest trip from Saturn, and being refueled and refitted and loaded on board and ship it out. No, just lift and throw and send it to the planet with the upper stage. And frankly, if you can do that, if you can organize the mission that way, right there, you've gone 90% of the way towards taking the mission out of the science fiction, fantasy future, and putting it in our universe of brass tacks engineering. 40 years ago, this country had launch vehicles that were superior by a factor of 7 to what we have today. Okay. So actually, you know, used to be, when you said space age, you meant cutting edge. Way into the future. But really, right now, we in the space program are kind of like Italians living in Italy around the year 800 AD. And we're wandering around among these magnificent ruins left over from Imperial Rome, these aqueducts and coliseums and temples and stuff, and looking at this amazing stuff and saying, we once built that. We want to build that. How could anyone build that? They had to be supermen to have built that. No one could build that. But they had built it. Okay? So similarly today, it's like people, they, you know, say, oh, you can't build a launcher to lift 100 tons to Leo. How could you? That's 5 times more than anything we have today? Well, we had it once, okay? And it was designed by people who didn't even have pocket calculators, okay? Anyway, it can be done, okay? It's just a question of having a mission which justifies engineering such a thing.
Because you don't have to release the escape tower every time, you don't have that as a necessary thing that has to occur with every flight. True capability is the very reason SpaceX was founded. So we will do whatever we need to do to make this happen.